My name is Uchenna Emelonye. I am the country representative of the United Nations Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights in Uganda. Uganda will be going through a general election in a couple of weeks, and the UN Human Rights Office is supporting the government of Uganda to conduct a human rights compliant election. Our normative involvement, our normative framework for election is predicated on the Constitution of Uganda, which draws strength from the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and the African Charter on Human and People's Rights. And most importantly, the host country agreement perfected between the office and the government of Uganda. All these instruments, all this framework, give us the authority to get involved in election. We are involved in election in a very narrow sense. We are not focusing on the legitimacy and credibility of an election. Rather, we are working to ensure that citizens enjoy their rights, exercise their right to vote and to be voted for. And this is a fundamental ingredient of election: right to vote for those who want to vote for candidates, and right to be voted for those candidates who want to stand and run for election. To engage in election, we developed an election strategy which has three key components. The first component is a pre-election phase, where we did the legal analysis of existing framework relating to elections and made a certification whether they are compliant in terms of non-discrimination and human rights standards. The second phase is the election itself, where we monitored the election. And the third phase is the post-election, where we advocated based on the monitoring findings we did during the election. In the pre-election phase, we analyzed the existing laws relating to election in Uganda and found as a fact that despite the recommendations for electoral reform in terms of law and policy in the last election, Uganda is going through this next election under the existing old framework. Literally to say that there was no improvement in terms of the legislative reform that were recommended and suggested by partners and even by the government of Uganda and civil society organizations. As part of our intervention pre-election, and based on the gap analysis that was conducted mutually with other partners, we began the capacity building of actors involved in election on grounds of in the area of human rights standards vis-a-vis election. We trained the National Human Rights Commission, we trained the journalists, we trained the electoral commissions, observers themselves, and the idea of this is to give them the skill to be able to pick out the sensitivities of human rights as they monitor election. In the election phase itself, we will be adopting a two-pronged approach to monitoring human rights on election day. First and foremost, we will be deploying the 32 staff members of the UN Human Rights Office to monitor human rights on election day. Secondly, we will be supporting the 221 staff members of the National Human Rights Commission to also monitor human rights in the context of election on election day. We will be supporting 500 civil society coalition to monitor human rights in the context of election. And today here in Uganda is the presidential and parliamentary elections. As the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, we are monitoring human rights in the context of election. And I am deploying 8 different teams, one team in Moroto, one team in Gulu, and 5 teams in Kampala.
Keep constantly in touch, always sending your reports as you receive them. We have all the contacts for the police commanders. We'll get in touch with them when necessary. Thank you. Thank you. Good luck.
Mrete Aragao is my name. I'm a field security officer for OSHR Uganda. Colleagues, good morning.
Good morning.
As there was a briefing earlier on, I am not going to get into details. Performing our duties, please don't put yourself in harm's way. Try to perform your duties as safe as possible. Let's keep contact on an hourly basis, as we discussed earlier. And I hope everything will go well. So at the end of the day, we come again to you.
That's what we remember the late Gaddafi before. Mm.
This commissioner office.
On 18th February,
OHCHR human rights monitors visited different polling stations to observe compliance to human rights. As the teams were deployed at the first polling stations, the voting exercise started normally at these places. A new innovation in the 2016 Uganda elections was the introduction of the biometric machine to prevent multiple voting.
Human rights in the context of election. So that's a lot of difference. I mean, there are election observers who look at the bigger picture of election, but we look narrowly on people being able to exercise their right, fundamental rights to vote.
So far, what is your observation regarding human rights?
We have gone through very few polling stations, and I think it's early in the hour, meaning that we have a lot of hoops to cover. But so far, the areas we've gone to, voting are going on peacefully, and in some areas, materials are delayed a little bit. So that's a verdict for now.
Any indications of it were alive or recently were what kind of violence?
We pray it doesn't happen, and at this stage, I wouldn't be able to make a comment on that. Things are relatively stable. It is still less than 11 o'clock in the morning, and we hope that it remains stable like this till the end of the day.
An enthusiastic voter demands that people stay away from restricted areas at this polling station. The queues were long as voters waited to cast their votes.
The presiding officer did not manipulate the biometrical device correctly. And as you can see, there's a security concern as well, because the population, the voters, are very close to the presiding officer. They already got angry because there are delays in opening the voting exercise. And the presiding officer is trying to consult with her supervisors on whether she should continue using the biometrical device or she should go with the registry. As she's waiting for instructions, people are getting a little bit desperate. They are getting angry, and this could be a trigger of violence in this polling station.
In the next polling stations, the OHCHR teams observed delays in the distribution of polling materials and ballot papers, which delayed the start of voting.
Told us that at 7 a.m. we have to be here for elections. Now it's going to 11.
Now what are we doing?
Just boxes.
It's in
It is so hard to get here very early, very soon up to date. We haven't seen anything here.
There appears to be tension here because up till 11 o'clock the materials are yet to arrive and people are getting a bit restive. I hope it will be able to be resolved sometime soon.
The boredom was evident as officials waited for voting materials to arrive. Finally, at about midday, polling materials arrive at this polling station for voting to start. However, in other polling stations, this distribution of electoral materials and ballot papers continued to delay even up to late afternoon. Early in the afternoon, as the heat of the sun increased and the waiting for electoral materials and ballot papers continued, some voters at polling stations around Kampala and Wakiso districts lost their patience and started complaining and demanding for the arrival of materials to start voting.
They brought the votes. We don't have the ballot papers for the presidency, president voting. And they want us to vote for the MPs only. And then another thing, they brought them very late. That's at 3:30. They are telling us their machines were programmed to start recording at 4. So are they going to finish the whole crowd at 4, by 4? That's why we are telling them either they give us another date or we cancel everything. We vote again. Because we have a right to vote.
I've come early around 7:30 in the morning to this hour. Haven't had anything like voting. Because this cannot happen in Kampala where each and every facility is open and each and every facility is immediate to us. And we haven't seen any ballot paper yet. And we haven't seen any presenting officer. Yet in most areas have already voted and are in voting process right now. This is a pity to Ugandans.
The situation is still moving up because I've seen people, they are still shouting and they have not cooled. So the situation is not yet calm. I hope, I've consulted my boss, they are saying that they are coming, but I hope, but at the time now, I think the election will not take place.
And you have consulted your boss from Electoral Commission?
I've got my supervisor, he says bringing
from
bringers.
Where?
My supervisor
from where?
Kansanga, Parish, said he is going to call the police. Which police have seen? They have already arrived here. So that's it.
In some occasions, police negotiated with the crowds to cool down. In other cases, police and the military made use of tear gas to disperse the agitated crowds. The delays in distributing electoral materials and ballot papers caused the Electoral Commission to postpone the voting exercise to the following day in Kampala and Wakiso districts at 16 polling stations. In the chaos of the previous day, voting could not be conducted. This caused the disenfranchisement of 1,689 voters. On the same day, the 19th February, as voting was taking place in these 16 polling stations, after midday, police stormed the headquarters of the FDC opposition party and arrested three leaders, including their presidential candidate. Since then, an intimidatory and heavy armored presence of military and law enforcement personnel was observed in Kampala and other parts of the country during the next days, especially after the announcement of the results of the presidential elections. During those days, the OHCHR office, in coordination with the Geneva OHCHR headquarters, issued two press statements about the human rights situation in the days of the elections. One of the statements mentioned the tense post-election situation, reporting at least two people killed and unknown number injured. The same statement mentioned heavy military and police forces deployed on the streets of Kampala. It also mentioned the FDC headquarters in Kampala evacuated by police and military with tear gas and live ammunition. The statement reminded the government of Uganda of its obligations under the international human rights law not to unduly restrict freedom of expression and peaceful assembly.
The elections, 2016 elections in Uganda, are officially concluded. OSHR Uganda actively monitors in three main locations, being Kampala, Gulu, and Moroto. And this is because this is where we have our office teams. We had to extend the monitoring, you know, beyond these three locations up to Western Uganda, because the elections triggered some ethnic conflicts, which had human rights consequences. So we had to monitor this after the elections. Now, on election day, the voting went on peacefully in most of the country. In Kampala, ballot materials were delivered in some areas quite late. This involved about 16 polling stations in Kampala and about 5 polling stations in neighboring Wakiso district. This triggered some arrest in certain places. We also noticed a very heavy military and police deployment within the city of Kampala. Of great concern to the office is the repeated arrest of the key opposition leader, Dr. Kizza Besigye, who was arrested on several occasions before the elections, on the day of the elections, and almost every day after the elections. The argument on the side of government is that it's for national security and peace. But the office advised, that while we're looking at the interests of national security and peace, human rights, should be favored. We continue our monitoring of the human rights situation, and we are supporting civil society who has put together, their findings. We are supporting them to launch and to disseminate, their findings.
As matters are rising in the post-election phase of the strategy, it's on record that one of the opposition candidates who has been detained regularly was not able to petition because apparently he was detained and he didn't have the access to assemble his evidence to file a petition before the Supreme Court before the expiration of the day. In any case, and however, another candidate was able to file a petition in the Supreme Court contesting the legitimacy of the election and the contest and praying that the election result should be upturned in his favor. Yesterday, the Supreme Court of Uganda gave a verdict, had this case and gave a verdict, which substantiates or validates the result as announced by the Electoral Commission. So effectively, and on grounds of rule of law, the President Museveni has been declared by the Supreme Court as the legitimate winner of the election.